Hey everybody, welcome. Today I'm going to talk about more about the Camera Lucida. Now you might remember the video I did recently about the Camera Obscura, and I mentioned this little see and draw copier toy from my childhood. My grandfather had ordered this from mail order, and it uses a piece of glass and a mirror and a little peephole device. And what it does, it superimposes an image of whatever you're looking at in front of you down onto your paper. And you can sit there and you can sketch it and outline it. And the original Camera Lucida device was a prism, a little prism. I think it had like five sides to it, and each facet, the angles had to be a certain angle, but it was mounted on a little arm and you looked down through it, and it basically did the same thing. It made an upright, right side up image of whatever you're looking at ahead of you down onto your paper. Well, I figured after having seeing how simple this little device is, which is essentially a little plastic box with a mirror, as you'll see when we're going to go build one in my garage. And let's go out to the garage and let's build a homemade Camera Lucida, shall we? So for our little Camera Lucida device, we're going to use a little 2-inch square rear surfaced mirror, 2 inches square. This mirror was from a project. I was making a bunch of little mirrors because I was going to make a solar collector, flat plate solar collector. There's my camera. And so I have a bunch of these spare 2-inch mirrors. So we're going to use a 2-inch mirror, and then we need a piece of clear glass, thin clear glass. And I have a scrap of thin picture frame kind of glass. This is around maybe 2 millimeters thick. I'll have to measure it, but it's pretty thin glass, and it's a scrap that I've had from my stained glass work in the past. So we're going to try to cut a piece out of this for the diagonal. And now, because this is 2 inches, this mirror, and the glass needs to be angled at a 45 degree like that, well, you have to sort of do a little bit of math to figure out that it's 1.414 times the height, which is about 2.82 inches roughly, is what this needs to be height-wise, and it needs to be 2 inches wide this way. So we're going to mark the glass and then cut it with and break it with some stained glass tools. Okay, so I have my piece of glass here. I'm going to measure off, so the width of it this way is just about 3 inches. So I'm going to do my 2-inch side this way, and I'm going to mark it with a Sharpie marker, a permanent marker. You have to clean the glass with alcohol, get all the grease off first, and then if you do that, the Sharpie marker will usually make a good line like that. All right, just like that. So there's a couple tools that you might need when you're doing this glass cutting, and you can get these at the craft stores anywhere they sell stained glass equipment and supplies. The first thing is this little scribe. It has a little cutting wheel, a scribing wheel that rolls, and the plastic body of this is filled with, you put a light oil in it, and so it lubricates the wheel. So when you make your little scratch on the glass, it'll make a nice clean little mark. Okay, that's the first thing you need. The second thing you need is a pair of these glass breaking pliers. And so the way these work is the jaws of these pliers are kind of angled like that. And when you, what you're going to do is you're going to put the piece of glass in here so that the scratch you made is along the peak of the jaw here, the little top of the curve. And when you squeeze the glass like this, what happens is the shape of those pliers is going to split the glass from the scratch on down into the body of the glass, and that'll make a nice clean break. You don't want to put the glass in where the scratch is on the bottom. It won't break good, but you have to do it so the scratch is on the top of the little curve there. So let's go ahead and inscribe the glass and see if we can get a good clean break. Well, you're gonna need a nice smooth surface, and you want absolutely no particles or crumbs or anything on it, because when you apply the pressure of this little cutting device, the scratching device, it will snap the glass. It'll break the glass if there's anything underneath there. So I'm using this little piece of marble. You're going to need a metal straight edge, and you kind of have to look at the width of your cutting wheel in terms of how far away to put the straight edge from the line so that your wheel is right on the mark. And that takes just a little bit of practice. You can kind of guesstimate it here. So I'm going to go ahead and start it like about there. And it makes a little scratchy noise, as you saw or heard. Okay, so now this is my glass, and you might be able to see the little, oh, here it is, a little scratch I made on the line. Then I'm going to put the jaws of the glass thing, and there's a mark on the top of the jaws here. I'm going to line up with my line. And if everything goes right, and if the camera gets in focus, it breaks like that. Huh? Nice, huh? Well, we figured that the long side of the piece of glass has to be about 2.82 inches. I'm going to make it at just about 2 3/4, 2.75. That'll give me a little bit of room to maneuver this in the enclosure that we're going to build. So I'm just going to measure, and I'm going to snap off the rough edge of the glass here, and I'm going to keep the clean edge over here. So I'm going to measure from the nice edge about 2 3/4, and my Sharpie marker is probably already drying out because I left the cap off, but you only need to really have a line good enough to see where you're scribing. All right, now make sure we're nice and clean here. So when we apply pressure of our cutting wheel, scribing wheel, there we go. All right, now this is pretty small. This is a pretty small piece that we're going to be scribing. The line is really close to the edge, so it may not break all that easy. We'll see. Hey, nice. Look at that. Nice, smooth break. It really helps to have thin glass, too. You know, this picture frame glass is probably 2 millimeters, a little bit less, maybe a millimeter and a half, which is roughly 1/16 of an inch, I guess. So okay, so before I do anything else with it, I'd like to smooth down some of these edges so I don't cut myself. And what I'm going to do for that is I'm going to use a metal file and with a little bit of water and try to scratch that down, try to file it down so it's a little bit safer to handle. I have this little file set, little metal file set, and there's a flat file here. And I put on some gloves because in case the little metal or the glass shavings. But so the thing is, I want to lubricate my file wet. I want to do this wet, and so I can wet the file, or I can wet the glass, or I can do both. So I'm going to just kind of put my glass in a cup of water here, just get it nice and wet, and I'm going to dip my file in the water, and now I'm just kind of. I'm holding this at about a 45 degree angle to the edge, and I'm kind of going back and forth. And the whole idea is just to file down the sharp edges. Feels better already. A little bit more water. You're just filing it at a 45 degree angle to the corner. And go around on all the corners. And also, I should mention, when you're doing this, you probably should wear some eye protection in case you get any glass shavings that fly up into your eye. Like that, we'll finish the rest of it. And I'm also going to file down the corners so that they're not sharp little points of glass. I'm gonna round them just a little bit. Wet my file a little bit more just to make them a little bit safer to handle. Okay, I've taken the piece of glass now to the kitchen and I've rinsed it under fresh water and gotten all the particles of glass off of it, and I'm just drying it with a paper towel now, but yeah, it looks like the corners and edges are all safe to handle now. And what you might want to do, a good idea once you've done this, is to put some light machine oil on your file. Wipe off the water and put some machine oil on it so this file doesn't rust. All right, a little bit of oil front and back. And spread it on the blade, on the file both sides, and then wipe off the excess. And your file should be well protected from rust. So the thing about making your own Camera Lucida is you could just take a piece of clear glass like this, thin, clear picture frame glass, and if you oriented it 45 degrees like this with the subject that way, you're gonna see a reflection of the subject on your paper down here. However, it's gonna be upside down. And so this is the whole reason why you have multiple reflective surfaces, and specifically on this mirror and glass method of making a Camera Lucida, we're going to put a mirror on the back side of the glass, and then we're going to actually angle the glass the other way. We're going to angle it like this, and in doing so you're going to see a right side up partial reflection in looking down, straight down from the top here. The mirror reverses the reflection, so you see it right side up then. And of course it's going to be like, actually like this, 2 inches wide and like that. Now we have to make the little enclosure box and the stand for it. And I'm just marking and cutting these pieces for the little mirror box out of black foam core board. I just had some scraps laying around. So I'm just going to use a little razor knife and a metal straight edge and just do some simple cuts. I'm going to put this together with hot glue gun and maybe gaffer's tape, my old standby materials for making these little quickly built little devices. So these are the two side pieces to the box. There are 2 1/8 inches square. Like that. And I have the back piece where the mirror sits. These are going to be the two side pieces. Like that. And then there'd be a top piece. Alrighty, and getting the second side wall put in. The trick to this is that the mirror I've already glued in place, and with a little hot glue, but being as how the hot glue is on the back side of the mirror, it means that the mirror is not sitting perfectly parallel because the glue is kind of uneven. But anyway, there are the two side pieces with the mirror in the back. And I have these two side pieces angled in just slightly, so when I put the piece of glass on, it'll hold it a little bit better. Okay, now I'm going to slip this piece of glass in like this. And then before I glue it into place, I kind of want to see and make sure that the angle of this thing is going to be right before I lock it into place. Should be pretty close though. So I'm gonna try to put it in there so it's along the diagonal. And I'm gonna put a spot of hot glue up on the end here. And I'll do one on the other side also, right here. Something like that, and then adjust it so it, when it hardens, it's at roughly the right 45 degree angle. And then along the bottom here, I'm going to put another bead of hot glue just to hold it in place. Let's see here. Alrighty, we'll let that harden up and see what we get. Okay, so I've marked the approximate center of the top piece with an X, and this is in the middle is where I want to put my hole, my peephole, for viewing down on through the device. The nice thing to do would be to use one of these quarter hole punches and simply slip it in here and punch the hole, but the problem is that the depth that this tool provides isn't it's too short to get all the way to the middle, so I'm going to have to use this puncher, which has a little bit longer of a reach, but it's a smaller hole. It's only about an eighth of an inch instead of a quarter inch. So I'm going to also, I'm going to have to push it hard against this edge and maybe go into that edge a little bit to get it all the way to the middle, but that's fine because we'll cover that up with a piece of gaffer's tape once we go there. Okay, hey. A viewing hole. So I'm going to glue this on and then I will we'll tape it up with gaffer's tape. Well, here we are. Our little device is almost finished. Of course, we have these little glue joints and we're going to just cover all the corners and sides or edges with some 1-inch gaffer's tape. And this gaffer's tape sticks pretty good to the scissors. And so what I've noticed works really well is if you cut the tape with the adhesive side up, it usually works a little better than trying to do it the other way. But your scissors might be different than mine. But I think for an experimental device like this, it's okay to make it out of these more simple materials, not quite as elegant. But just covering up our glue joints with gaffer tape makes a lot of difference in the appearance of it. And then also what I can do, as I'll probably end up covering the corners, the edge of the open edges also with some, so you don't see that rough foam core look there. Okay, well, we're gonna have to figure out how to make a stand, a support stand for this. Okay, well, I finished taping the open edges of the box, and you notice down here I had to bevel the tape at a 45 degree angle so it wouldn't interfere with the mirror or the glass. But anyways, there it is. And so, necessity being the mother of invention, I always try to scrounge around my workshop and whatever to find stuff I can use. Here is one way that I might be able to mount this Camera Lucida. I have a heavy desktop microphone stand, and I happen to have a wooden dowel, like a broom handle dowel, that fits quite snugly in the microphone holder. And I can alter the angle of this up and down, and I can also extend it back or forward, and so I can have my drawing paper right down here. I just now need to figure out how to mount the Camera Lucida to the end of the wooden dowel. Now, because I'm right-handed, I'm going to mount it so that the microphone stand is off to the left here. If you're left-handed, you can of course do the opposite. So scrounging around in my spare parts bin, I found this little storm door hinge bracket thingamajiggy. I always save this kind of hardware. But I noticed that it has this open end here, these two metal plates, and it kind of sits right here real nicely on the end of the wood, and I think I can put a tie wrap through this hole, tie wrap it here, and maybe tape it here, and then I'm going to hot glue gun this to the side of the Camera Lucida, and then I can adjust the angle of the microphone stand to get the Camera Lucida to be horizontal, and then I can extend it out in and out to get the length of it. And I'm also going to tape the bracket with some gaffer's tape along with the hot glue gun just to reinforce it. So there is my mount, my mounting bracket. Now I need to attach it to the wooden dowel. So I said earlier that I like the way this wooden dowel hits up against the little corner here, but actually if I move it all the way up to the box, then I can I can use tie wraps on both this hole and back here on this hole. So that's what I'm going to do here. See if I can get this in place. And see if it will hold. Of course, get the loop started. And now I have to kind of tighten them up. That's about as tight as they're getting. Okay, so to align this, you first want to rotate the rod, the dowel, until it's looking straight down. And then you're going to alter the angle of the microphone stand until it's parallel. The surface is parallel to the work surface, like that. Then you can extend it up or down for the size of paper that you're using. Cool. This might actually work. Okay, so just a test here. I'm just looking straight ahead at my workbench, and I think there is the drill press, bracket, all the stuff there. Just trace the lines. Seems like it's real easy. Well, the real question about the Camera Lucida is this thing going to make me an artist? Is it going to turn me instantly into an artist? I don't really think so. It's just an aid for getting the dimensions and sizes of objects pretty much equivalent on paper as you're sketching or painting or drawing. You know, it's an optical aid, but it's not going to make you an artist. You have to have that kind of skill already. I mean, I can trace out these lines real simply on the scene I was looking at, but that doesn't necessarily mean I'm going to be able to sketch like an artist. So it doesn't turn you into an instant artist, but it is an interesting little optical device. It goes back a number of centuries, and it does work. It actually helps you to sketch things accurately. Now, there's a couple caveats to using this. First of all, the relationship between your eye and the device has to be fixed, which is why you need a relatively small hole right there. So you only want to look down on it from one angle. Secondly, the relationship between the device itself and your piece of paper that you're drawing on down below it has to be absolutely rigid. You don't want any movement between the device and the easel where the piece of paper is, which means you're going to want to probably tape down the piece of paper to a work surface, a drawing board, and you're going to want to have either a really heavy base like this that doesn't move, or clamp it to the same drawing board so the relationship between that device and the paper stays the same. If it moves, then all of a sudden you'll find your drawing has shifted. So that could be a problem if you're doing something like this, right? That there is no real locking screw on this particular model of AKG microphone stand. Maybe if I popped off the cap on one of these, there might be some kind of a screw, but just be aware of the fact that you don't want to go bumping this or pushing the arm up or down or even pivoting it like that. You have to keep everything very, very consistent in order to complete a whole drawing. And obviously, the relationship of the drawing surface to the subject has to remain constant. So you're not going to be able to use this thing on your lap. You can't just set a drawing board on your lap, because that whole drawing board moves in relation to the image of the object. So you're going to have to put this on a firm table, have everything set down rigidly, and all the relationships between the subject, the device, and the drawing surface and the paper all have to be maintained perfectly rigid in order for it to work. So after having finished the Camera Lucida on this little tabletop microphone mount with its little broom handle and the little bracket and all that, I took it here into my office in the late afternoon sun coming in through the windows just a few minutes ago, and I have this little wooden decoy duck sitting on my little bookcase, and I sat here and I basically tried to do as good of a job as I could with sketching it and try to do a little bit of shading and whatnot. And so this is my first attempt at using it for any serious kind of art. What I've done is I've taped down two of the corners of the paper with drafting tape or artist tape so the paper doesn't move. The heavy base of the microphone stand, you want to have the device totally immobilized so the relationship between the device and the paper doesn't change. Now, of course, you could bump it and move it, but you don't want to do that. You want to leave it as fixed of a position as you can. Now, of course, my tray table wobbles, but I was propping it up on one leg, so it was going to be steady. So I tried to have everything as consistently as possible. And let's take a look and see what I got. No, it's not a great work of art by any means, but hey, you know, it kind of looks like a decoy duck, you know? It has the shape and the outline, and I tried to get the texture of the little wings that were painted on and the little feathers, I mean, and all that, and the shading from the afternoon light. So I tried to do a fairly decent job, and I'm certainly no artist, but it can certainly help you in defining a realistic outline and shape of an object. Now, if you're interested in making one of these for yourselves, there's a little bit of advice I would give you in terms of using it. You have to be very careful about the relationship between how brightly illuminated the subject is and how brightly illuminated your paper is, because your paper obviously is white colored, so it's going to be kind of really bright anyways. But depending on how bright the subject is illuminated, you might find that you can't easily see where your pencil is. So what I was doing is I was using my left hand, the hand that I wasn't drawing with, I was temporarily blocking the view of the subject so I could just see the paper and see where my pencil was. And then I would open it up and then I could see the image on the paper. And that's how I sort of got my initial lines going, so I could get the relationships of the drawing lines superimposed, overlapped exactly as possible onto the actual image outlines. So kind of covering it up and revealing it as I went, I was able to do that. I think if you're going to spend a lot of time seriously drawing with this device, you want to have some kind of a little light that you could control the brightness of, that you could illuminate the subject matter and maybe turn it up and down, and maybe a light on the paper itself that you could control the brightness of as well. So, but it definitely works, and I think it is a real aid to sketching and drawing, but it doesn't make you an artist. You still have to have artistic talent, but it is a tool that can enable you to maybe reach those higher levels of talent quicker. You have yourselves a great day.